want to start off talking about the historical and cultural context of Louisiana. Now, normally I give this lecture right before Mardi Gras, and we just missed Mardi Gras, so Mardi Gras already started, so sorry. But this is a little bit of everything. This is my crash course, and Vanessa can correct me whatever I get wrong here. So this is, anybody besides Vanessa know what this is? Café du Monde, yes. So this is this famous place for beignets.
Yes.
Yes, see? Sadie's going to go get some beignets there. So this is the famous place. It's all eating food and that's it. So this is a picture from about 75, 80 years ago. And this is a famous spot in the French Quarter. We'll talk about the French Quarter in a little bit. But in the sort of epicenter of the heart of New Orleans. And this is a place that they claim is continuously operating since 1887 or some such thing. It's a little baloney because they didn't continuously operate during Katrina, but nevertheless, the place where everybody goes to get these fried donut-like pastries covered in powdered sugar. And it's a very emblematic part of Louisiana culture. The first thing to say is that New Orleans truly is an American city and is very much so a blending of all different kinds of cultures. And it didn't blend and then stop. It blends to this day. And as we'll learn, for example, Hurricane Katrina brought about the most recent blending, in this case, interjecting a lot of Hispanic folks from that moved into the city to do work and add their, while we had their influence before, it was a new shot of Mexican food and Mexican radio stations and culture and all that kind of good stuff. But let's step back a little bit. Let's start at the beginning. Native folks were living here for at least the last 10,000 years before present. It's crazy that folks lived there before air conditioning, before we had roads, before we had all these things. I mean, it truly was a challenging landscape in which to engage. A beautiful landscape, amazing landscape, but an interesting place. The Mississippi River, which drains a bit more than 40% of the continental U.S. Let me say that again. The Mississippi River drains. So if a drop of rain falls in about, of the lower 48 states, about 40% of that raindrop falling across the entirety of the continent is going to exit the continent through the Mississippi River Delta. So a huge drainage basin. Consequently, this area was a consistent, I mean, now the river itself moved over thousands of years and stuff, but a river going from the interior of what we now call the United States to the Gulf of Mexico has been there for thousands and thousands of years. And so it was and still remains a major transportation hub. And everything that you associate with that, trade, culture, all that stuff. We got New Orleans where we got because of European exploration. When these French traders and French explorers were coming around, this is when European empires were invading North America and taking over territory. So these folks came on in, and they were grabbing territory, and they were, one, grabbing territory, two, thinking about how they could solidify their control. And so because these competitors are coming along, they're trying to figure out, hey, what can I do? So these guys looked around, Iberville and Bienville came on up the river, and they said, hey, we want to find a place that is dry year-round. The Mississippi River is this classic thing. And again, we said 40% of the U.S. water's come down. So in the flood season, the river's going to swell its banks, oftentimes go over the top of its banks, over the natural levees, and flood the area. So it can be a difficult landscape to, say, build a fort or build a trading post or something like that. So they were coming up the Mississippi River from the mouth, going upstream. And they were looking for a place that would remain dry year-round. So even when we had the big floods, it would still be a place that we could make a base of operations and wouldn't worry about going subtidal. They broke off from the main river where the native folks they were talking to said, "Hey, man, there's some great fishing grounds over here." And so they portaged off. They went inland to this great fishing grounds, and that was this thing called Pontchartrain. So there's also crazy pronunciations, as we'll learn. And so this is Lake Pontchartrain. It's called Lake Pontchartrain. It's not technically a lake. It's a big, huge, almost a lake, but it actually connects to the ocean. So it's really just a truncated embayment, but everybody calls it Lake Pontchartrain. And in this huge, amazing saltwater lake was where the Native Americans found all kinds of seafood to feast on and fish. And so that's why the why New Orleans is where it is. The point where where they first camped was actually a little teeny bit, not exactly the French Quarter, not exactly the middle of New Orleans, but very close by. They wanted it, one, because they wanted it to be that nice dry place, but also they wanted a defensible area. So if anybody else was coming up the river, they could, another, you know, imperial power, they could defend themselves. And so they came, they first found it in one of their early exploratory trips. They come back and they formally start a trading post a few years later. And so that's where we get, that's why New Orleans is where New Orleans is. And this particular picture is from 1726. So what you can see here is here we're on the south, so our butt is toward the ocean, and our face is towards Canada, and so we're looking up. And you see, while this is stylized to be sure, I think it illustrates a bunch of key things. So firstly, let's have a look at this. Firstly, here is the water. This green stuff is the water. Okay, this is the Mississippi River. And it's a little bit confusing when we first go because the Mississippi River is going from the north to the south, but there are these big, huge oxbows. Right? We call it, one of the nicknames for New Orleans is the Crescent City, right? This sort of curving of the river around the city. And in this case, it can be very easy to get turned around, and sometimes it looks like the river is flowing northwards because it is, because of all these twists and turns. So right here, we're looking up. The water is flowing from the left side of the screen to the right side of the screen. We're looking straight across at what would be the French Quarter, the old part of the town, the original part of the town. And what you see is, you see river, then you see a little bit of a town carved out of this big wooded swamp. Herbaceous plants, grassy plants that are wetlands. And wetlands just means some time of the year wet, some time of the year dry. There's legal definitions we could talk about, but that's basically what it means. If it's just plants without wood, if it's herbaceous plants, we call that a marsh. If it has woody plants on it, we call that a swamp. They're both different types of wetlands. And so what we see here is we see the city of New Orleans is basically surrounded by forested wetland, by swamp. You'll also hear me refer to it as bottomland hardwood forest. That's a sort of more ecological term for this community. And it's one of the main things we're working on restoring as part of our long-term effort to help our friends in Louisiana. And so what we see here is we see the city carved out, just carved right out, whoop, 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 out of the swamp. And then look, then there's some connections here. And this thing back in the foreground, in the far background, that's the lake. That's Lake Pontchartrain. And you can see there's clearly piers and some fishing activity stuff there. Now this here is going to be essentially a drainage ditch, a natural drainage ditch that would help keep the city drier than it otherwise would be. Oh, great question. Okay, so So now there's, I have probably in the next lecture I'll show you, but if we did a cross section of the Mississippi River, I'm going to make it exaggerate. It's going to look like that. So if this is the water in here, just the natural the way sediment is deposited, the banks of the river will normally get built up. And so that natural earthen mound is called a levee. So there's naturally levees on either side of the river. So here there would be, again, this is a sort of a bit of a caricature picture, but there'd be a levee right here. These guys are probably standing on a levee, and there's a levee right here. Have a look. The levee is high. So actually, the highest ground, the driest ground, ironically, is the stuff right next to the river. That's why the French Quarter, the old square here, is close to the river and not farther into the trees. That's the highest, driest place. And that'll play out next time we start talking about what happened with Hurricane Katrina. That you'll see how that plays out in terms of where people live and who got more damage and all this and that. But then have a look. Look, in addition to that, we have some people doing activity here. There's clearly some trading going on and all kinds of neat stuff happening. So even in this point in time, we can look at some of these historic maps and get some insights into what was going on, what the status of the area was like. So then this is an example of, so the Great Game was coined with sort of the British and Russian empires when they're, you know, fighting to slaughter each other because they thought that was fun. And this was sort of our American version of that, which was the Spanish empires, the British empires, everybody's mupping around, doing stuff, doing all this crazy jazz. And so the U.S. was carved up into different territories, right? So this is a map from, 1683. And while it's clearly not super accurate, they're beginning to get the sense of things. But have a look. The area they pay the most attention to is the coastal zone, right? So this is not exactly correct, but it's pretty good for, you know, 400, 500 years ago. And they have this notion of Florida being sort of projecting down into the Caribbean. And then over here is Louisiana. And so that's where these guys are going. We have these waves, these rolling waves of people controlling New Orleans. So New Orleans is this outpost place, not a lot going on. It's not like on the eastern seaboard we have city, 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 city. All kinds of folks come through here. Let's see if I have it in the next slide. Let me just say, but you can see immediately, again, here's another image of the old part of the city. So here's the river, and then this is the French Quarter, also called the Vieux Carré, the old square, the old town, and you know, very traditional European straight lines, very organized in terms of the city layout, right? And I'll just say that. Then we start to have different things happen. So, for example, we have tragedy. We have a disease. Mosquito-borne diseases are a huge problem. Also, back in the day, especially early on when the city was built of wood, it was kind of sketch, right? Remember, this is a place that routinely gets way over 100 degrees, routinely gets, you know, high 90s in terms of humidity, so it's a tough place. So you don't have a lot of dainty folks walking around, right? It's sort of the more hardcore type of folks that want to be in a place that's not maybe always super comfortable, doesn't have all the luxuries of you know, King Louis's court or whatever. And in the midst of this, we have these disasters. So folks have to be very resilient. So we have, there's a series of fires that come through and burn and destroy the city. One of these fires comes through and has a huge effect. So the town says, what are we going to do? We're going to respond to that. We're going to rebuild with brick, because brick is more resistant. Um, So again, so these guys found the city. It's progressing, and here's a quote from 1721. So this one father, this one priest is there, and he says, "New Orleans is a place of 100 wretched hovels in a malarious, wet thicket of willows and dwarf palmettos, infested by serpents and alligators." Right? That's how people thought of this place. So it's not like, I don't know, Palm Springs or something, right? That's right. It's kind of like, here. Soon after, New Orleans becomes the capital for the French holdings in this part of the world. And again, we have this notion of disasters, natural disasters coming in, either biological or climactic, that cause people to reshift, redo the government, rebuild, all that jazz. The first big transition, start with French, goes to Spain, because Spain wins the territory in some crazy wars, right? So they take over. Now there's people that are living there, but all of a sudden now they're told, oh, by the way, you're a Spanish citizen. And they're like, uh-huh, right? This happens in 1763. The Spanish governor doesn't show up for 3 years, right? This is before Twitter. And so these people are kind of like doing their shtick, right? Like, what, we're Spanish now? Whatever, right? So again, all these disasters and things going on, and these folks very much so isolated from the daily goings-on, the routine politics and this and that of the either the European powers or the parts in North America that are more easily accessed by the European powers. I mentioned the Great Fire in 1788 that leads the town to be rebuilt with bricks. That's why it looks the way it does today. That's why we have New Orleans Square at Disneyland. Well, I don't think so. So Walt Disney, this is a sidetrack, but so Walt Disney really, really, really loved New Orleans. And he wanted to build Disneyland just out in a place called New Orleans East, in eastern New Orleans, and bought land and all this and that. And then he ran into what's called Louisiana politics. And they said, no, you're not going to do that unless you're going to give us a lot of money. So he said, basically, screw you. So he left and he went back to California and said, we're going to do it here. That's why one of the first parts he built in Disneyland was New Orleans Square, because he really liked the iconic look of the place. So there's another part as to why it looks so iconic that we'll get to in a second. But so we're switching, right? We're switching control. France takes over again. And then Napoleon starts fighting all these wars. And Napoleon likes to fight wars. And he kept like losing and getting his butt kicked, and he'd kind of go away, then he'd come back. And he'd go, hey, I'm back, right? And so let's fight some more wars. And so he was draining the treasury, so they needed some money. So he started talking to his allies in the U.S., right? And Jefferson and all these guys. He said, hey, maybe we need some cash. What can you guys do for us? And so that was the famous Louisiana Purchase that were the United States overnight, everything from Oregon, Louisiana, Oregon, up all through the middle part of the U.S., we purchased it all and didn't even know what we purchased. So this is the map of the Louisiana Purchase on a cotton sack from a museum, and it shows this map. I mean, look at all this. This is huge, right? I mean, incredible deal. For something like, I forget what it is now, I should know, it's like $5 million or something, and people thought this was the most stupid thing, and oh my God, you didn't even know what you bought. It was an incredible, deal, purely on real estate grounds. We won't get into the injustice of purchasing the land where other people live and stuff like that, but crazy stuff. Oh, there we go, look, I wrote it down right there. So it's $15 million, $15 million. So, and when I last calculated this in 2014 dollars, that was $312 million. Still an incredible steal, right? That's crazy. That's totally crazy. Okay, so I think it's clear that New Orleans is sort of outsidery type folks, right? Outside the typical social norms. So Jean Lafitte is a classic figure who's a pirate. I like pirates. And all these folks that could make a living in a challenging landscape. Combining that with the big transportation hub meant that these folks that were outside the traditional norms of society nevertheless could earn money, could start to make either legal or otherwise through all the trade that was beginning to grow up because the U.S. purchased the made the Louisiana Purchase and other things. So what else do I want to say? Okay, yeah. So we keep going through these constant waves of possession and shifting and all that kind of stuff. The reason that New Orleans looks the way it does is primarily because those fires that caused us to rebuild with bricks and that cool, you know, wrought iron work and all that cool stuff. But then the key thing is it was the only city in the South that was not sacked in the Civil War. So everywhere else, every big city, Savannah, whatever, that had all this stuff, they were pillaged. Either they were blown up in battle, or the Union troops coming in, like, you know, burned everything down. Not New Orleans. And purely by luck. So while the rest of the South was under Confederate control, Captain Farragut sails up and just boom boom. This is New Orleans. This is ours, basically, right? Puts up a flag and says thanks. And there's no battles, so people aren't shooting each other or anything like that. There's a few little things that happen after, but nothing like our other cities. And so there were no major battles fought there. And so the city, the structure of New Orleans persists, the largest such city in the southern U.S. to survive. We also have all of the history of slavery, of course, that's going on here, right? And so so we have all that, but also it's a little bit different compared to some other places, again, because of this sort of pirate, this sort of outside the social norm goings on. But make no mistake, there absolutely was all the injustice and horror that we saw have happening elsewhere was happening. This is a slave auction in the city of New Orleans. And so all this comes together to help create all different parts of this culture. So African slaves are forming part of the culture of Louisiana. Spanish culture is forming part of the culture. French culture is forming part of the culture. Native American activities are food and all that kind of stuff is all coming together and it's all blending together. So for example, the most famous thing that you guys know about, which was last Tuesday, is Mardi Gras. And so that's Fat Tuesday. So this is a Catholic holiday. So we have a similar version everywhere around the world that has significant Catholic populations. So we know it as Carnival in Brazil, different names in different places. So the idea here is this is the French influence. So the French are Catholic, not English. The English aren't Catholic for some historical reasons. So these guys, and as you'll hear about when we go to the New Orleans School of Cooking, there's reasons why people want people to be Catholic because then they can count them and they can get sort of political power and stuff. So everybody's basically a Catholic, essentially, if you're in New Orleans early on. So what is this? So if you guys aren't Catholic or whatever, if you don't know the history, so this is the lead up to Easter. So in a religious society, this is a big deal. And so this is going to emulate Jesus goes out in the desert and spends 40 days out in the desert. So this is going to replicate that. So leading up to Easter, which is the most important holiday in the Christian calendar, we're going to have this time of sacrifice. So the last day before we have to sacrifice, let's have a party, right? And so that's what, and so it starts on Ash Wednesday and goes through Good Friday, which is a 40-day period. And so the day before Ash Wednesday, where you have to start to be like, whatever, don't eat candy and stuff like that, right? You have the last day to do whatever you want to do, right? To indulge whatever the things you like to indulge in. And so this very quickly, mixes with all of these cultures, and it becomes this notion of doing things you're maybe not otherwise supposed to do. So it starts this tradition of masked revelry. And there's all kinds of things that can come along with that mask, right? If you are maybe restricted as to what you can do because of your color or because of your station in life, if you put a mask on, it's way easier to hide, right? And so it gives people a lot of autonomy. It gives people a lot of freedom to mix with groups in society they maybe don't typically mix with. So by 1781, which is a long time ago, the city leaders are saying, this is horrible, man. You know, all the people are mixing, you know, together, you know, the gays and the straights and the blacks and the whites and like all this stuff. I don't know about that, right? And so you see these that's right. So you see these waves of like, what? That's not right. And then they will have some kind of constraint. They sort of stop for a little bit and then they go, blah, 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 and then it just comes right back and they can't stop it kind of thing. And so this is everything from, yeah, you guys can imagine, it's everything, right? So all kinds of stuff goes on. So, for example, in the 1800s, when the different governments outlawed stuff, people just kind of say, eh, okay, and they just keep going on. The next evolution that we get in Mardi Gras is this notion of cruise, spelled with a K, and parades. So Mardi Gras has both balls, where we would go, and you know, a masked ball or a masquerade ball or just a regular ball, where people dress up in generally nice clothes, and there's that side of things. But then there's also stuff out in the streets, right? And so the streets evolve into these parades, and there's crews. And so crew is what you would think of as a club, basically. And modeled after, a lot of slaves that would escape would go out and hang out with or could get refuge oftentimes with the Native American tribes. Because again, this is swampland, really hard to navigate. So you could hide fairly easily if you're with someone that knew how to navigate this landscape, and pretty hard to find those folks. So partly out of respect for the Native Americans that helped them so much, a lot of the culture that begins to grow up uses Native American headdresses and Native American decorations and adornments and beadwork and things like that. And so again, it's a huge mixing pot. Everything is mixing and it's going this way and that way and woo, 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 woo. And we come together and people say, look, we're doing great because we're not doing horrible things. We're in a parade. And it's a good time. So that's Mardi Gras. Here's an image. This is from, 1876? And so this is in Harper. So this is like the national magazine at the time, showing stuff. And so you see folks in all kinds of crazy garb and such. But then you also have images like this. This is the late 1800s, and this would be more of a parade, right? So you have folks going down the middle. They're doing stuff. There's people dressed up as bottles, and you know. So this is back in the day. This isn't some MTV created thing, right? This is very much an organic thing that burbles up out of the culture. People originally started throwing coins to kids that would say, hey, throw me something. And those coins evolved into little chocolates, and those coins evolved into other things. And that's where we get throws. I'm skipping around here. So now Mardi Gras is a Mardi Gras season. So Mardi Gras starts from Twelfth Night, which is the Epiphany, which is the day that the wise men go and give their gifts to Jesus, all the way up to Fat Tuesday. And so as we progress, the parties get more and more crazy and intense. And certain crews, certain parades happen on certain days with their traditions and all that kind of stuff. The most famous crews are these guys, Babylon, Bacchus, Comus, Zulu, and Rex. Each of these crews elects a king and queen, and they ride on the chosen, high-profile part of the float. People spend the entire year making these floats. They spend the entire year making these costumes. And so this is not something they do once. This is the culmination of a bunch of daily, weekly, monthly activities that they do in various parts around the city and elsewhere. And so, as I said, what started with people throwing little coins and chocolates and stuff evolved to now. So everybody knows, everybody's seen people throw necklaces and beads, right? Most recently, the beads used to be made out of glass because back in the Cold War, the Eastern Bloc, one of the few things they could export were glass beads, and they were really cheap. So back in the day, the beads used to be all glass. And then since the fall of the Cold War, now it's cheaper to get plastic beads made in China, so now most of those things are made of plastic. But there's lots of things that you can get. And so each crew will have its own flavor of throws. And some throw things like cabbage, some throw coconuts. So you have to be kind of careful because you can be sort of taken out by some of these things. Right, and so like I said, so we have these parades, we have mass balls, and then we have all kinds of fantastic music. And so one key part of our trip is, I mean, we won't be able to be there for a Mardi Gras parade, but we'll be able to see a lot of great songs. And the classic music that accompanies these parades are so-called second line brass bands. So second line comes from the tradition. Oh, so I should also say that a lot of the folks that were marginalized didn't have access to stuff. You can imagine if you were a freed slave and you wanted to get some health insurance or something like that, hard to come by. So in addition to spinning off or to creating the phenomenon of crews, we also have this phenomenon of social clubs, or also called social aid clubs. And so this would be something that you could maybe even want to sense like a YMCA kind of thing, a sort of place to go, but also a place to get resources and help with stuff. So for example, you can get insurance, you can get burial insurance, stuff like that. And so one of the things that you could do is you could make sure that you had a nice send-off, for example. So one of the traditions that emerged is when people would do stuff, not just a Mardi Gras party, but maybe your mom passed away or what have you, is you would have the parade, the first part of the parade, the float, say, or the whatever's going to go forward, and then the musicians are going to follow behind in the second line. So that's where the name second line comes from. And it's a parade. It's people walking, not on cars, but walking, following whatever the procession is, and that's where we get our second line from. Okay, a couple different groups that we have. We'll just touch on. There's a lot. We'll just touch on a few. So the first are the Cajuns. Cajun. And so these guys are, the name comes from Acadian. So these were folks up in Canada of French descent. The British win, right, kick their butts, and say, hey, now Canada, this part of Canada is English territory. You're out of here. So they were afraid that if they just took these people and dislocated them, that they would come back and say, uh-huh, we want our land back, right? So instead, they put them on boats, shipped them down the East Coast, took them around Florida, and then went along the Gulf Coast. And because they were afraid that they would get together, they took 50 of them and said, hey, you guys are off here. Like, what? And they threw them off. And they would go another, whatever, 50 miles, and they'd throw another 50 people off. And so they basically sprinkled them throughout the Gulf Coast, hoping that they wouldn't, you know, reband and somehow try to take back stuff. So that's where we get this. And so the Cajuns are French-speaking, although if you speak French, it's sometimes hard to understand what they're saying sometimes. So this is basically the country folks, right? So these are the folks that we most know from their zydeco music. So this would be washboard is a classic instrument here, accordion, key instrument here. And it's basically country music, Louisiana country music. A lot of a fiddle also in their music. So these folks are living out in the swamp primarily, so especially southern Louisiana. Their food is dominated by rice dishes because they're living in the most flooded parts of Louisiana, so where rice will grow, wild rice and stuff will grow well. And they have a lot of spicy dishes. And Yeah, and so like I said, so they speak basically a dialect of French. Then we have Creole. So the term Creole has evolved over time. So Creole basically means a mix of folks. Okay, and so again, even though we talked about New Orleans as being this big mixing pot and melting pot and all that, all this and that, we still have all of the baggage that we unfortunately have with a lot of our human society, which is sort of, I look like me, so you're not part of my deal, right? And so initially, the term Creole was to separate folks that were here, quote unquote, original folks from recent immigrants. But it pretty quickly began to evolve into something that means not so much that, it just means you're not part of wherever your parents came from. So if you're black, if mom's black and your dad's white, you're neither black nor white. So the Creole folks were had a hard time in many cases because they weren't necessarily accepted in either community. They really helped give us slave songs, a lot of the narratives that come out of that. Congo Square, we'll talk about that in a little bit. And then form the roots of what we now consider to be jazz music. Their traditional Creole food would be also a lot of rice dishes. So they really have the Holy Trinity. You'll learn about this when we go to cooking school, but that are in just about every single Creole dish. So that's going to be celery, bell pepper, and onions. And importantly, they bring gumbo with them. So they have this okra, which is this sort of root that when you put it in water thickens stuff. So it really makes more kind of stewy type foods. And so a lot of our stuff like this is comes from Creoles via their African heritage. Yeah, there's all kinds of cool food we're going to eat. So the classic food stuff, hope we're going to be there for a while. You guys should talk to folks, find out about their culture. The easiest entry points, though, for you guys getting the culture are going to be music and food, right? So use those. Use those as great starting points. Don't stop there, right? Let's find out what else these folks are doing with visual art and what their stories are and stuff. But these are the easy ways to get in. So the classic foods you guys should all sample. I know some people like, Jay, don't like spicy foods, but you at least want to taste some of this stuff, right? Check it out. Try it. So the classic stuff we have is gumbo, jambalaya, which is a rice dish, po' boys, which are submarine sandwiches. It could be anything. It could be seafood. It could be meatballs. It could be whatever. Well, one day we'll go to this one place, and they'll have just 1,000 different types of po' boys. Pralines, so which are oftentimes sweetened. Beignets, you pronounce this guy beignet. Those sort of fried donuts with powdered sugar. Then classic, one of my favorites, red beans and rice. So that's the classic dish you eat on a Monday. I mean, you can eat stuff whenever you want, but traditionally you eat that on Monday. Crawfish, we'll have at least one crawfish boil while we're there. We sometimes call these crayfish, same thing. And then a lot of seafood, and in general, a lot of hot, spicy stuff. So the best thing, if you guys want to try stuff, but you're not into the spicy stuff, order some milk with that, and that'll help a little bit. And this is John Lambrinos from Oregon State, and this is one trip we were decided to get some dessert, and he was wondering why there was an In-N-Out sticker because there's no In-N-Out in Louisiana. But okay, then we have all kinds of really cool visual art. This is in Jackson Square, which is sort of the middle of the French Quarter. All kinds of neat stuff. So if you guys are looking for stuff to get mom or your significant other or whatever, you can get all kinds of stuff. But I would implore you to maybe go a little bit beyond just the t-shirt shop, which you can always do, and look for some cool stuff. There's a lot of wonderful artists, musical artists, visual artists, et cetera, that have historically been attracted to the city of New Orleans, and it's an epicenter for creative culture that's pretty cool. So it's just a couple examples here. you know, a lot of the art is very bright. It's very, so a lot of people, like our friend Harry Shearer, calls New Orleans not an American city, but the northernmost port in the Caribbean. A lot of Caribbean influences. So you'll see a lot of bright colors, a lot of kind of whang, bang, you know, kind of bright stuff, like on the right. And you'll see a lot of stuff that is oftentimes some people might consider irreverent. So these are some artists that for the first few years were going and recovering doors after recovered doors post-Katrina flooding. And so this is a door that there's an X on, right? So we'll talk about those. But that's essentially what the search and rescue personnel used to look for people post-Katrina. And so this is a standard thing for search and rescue. So you do an X, and it breaks it into four quadrants. It says the date that it was checked over there. This FL, this is the team that looked, so Florida 1, I don't know what that was, a fire department or some team from Florida. And then this is how many people, how many dead bodies were inside. And so that was how you know that when you came back that this house had been checked and that you could go on to the next one and see if someone needed aid or assistance or whatever. And so these guys sort of took those doors like, hey, let's paint them up, right? So taking something that was tragedy maybe and turning it into something different. And then, of course, music. So this is our friend Irvin Mayfield playing Snug Harbor, which is a great place. And jazz is one example of art forms that we have that really was an American creation, that was really different from our other colleagues around the world and really is something that we contributed to world culture, I would argue. So let's pick up where we paused there for a second. So, all right, let's talk about the origin of what we would consider the New Orleans sound. So this has a lot of, you know, people have done whole PhD dissertations, and I'm obviously not very well-schooled in all the different meanderings, but from what I've read and what I know, these are the key things that form, that come together in the 19th century to start to create the New Orleans sound. So first and foremost, we have a city. New Orleans is not like the surrounding areas. They have an opera. They have actual brass instruments. You know, brass instruments, hot, sweaty area, muggy area. You have to maintain them. Things rust. So in an urban situation, you might have a hope of maintaining those kinds of instruments, right? So we have operas and orchestras. So a lot of these folks have been what we would consider classically trained. They've learned all the, you know, classic composition and classic songs and things of that nature. Next, a lot of marching bands. We already mentioned this. We had the second line tradition. So marching bands, a lot of loud, a lot of brassy, a lot of clear, a lot of drums, right? A lot of to get people to march. We then have the tradition of minstrel shows, which are shows for, a very negative connotation now, but nevertheless, this notion of folks performing and going around, right? So pulling in songs from the neighboring communities, from the neighboring towns and stuff was an important thing here. Obviously, our slave work songs, so a lot of the bass of the blues and that sort of repetition again, because similar to sea shanties on the sea where people are working hard to pull up sails, here people are working hard in the field. And it's obvious, it works for me, when I'm doing something that's hard, a little music gets you motivated, right? Especially music with a rhythm. And so we have the tradition of slave work songs, and then we have all the polyphonic rhythms coming out of West Africa. And so this is one example I played earlier. So, So clearly a blues song.
It was soon one more. Death come creeping. Soon one. Death come creeping in my room.
So, song about maybe a depressing subject, right, or depressing things, but by putting it to music sort of helps people deal with it, right? So we have, so this sort of, you know, consequence of all those things come together to produce this kind of music. So the other thing that we have to talk about is Congo Square on Sundays. So now, unlike other parts of the South, and this wasn't completely universal, not everybody, but it was fairly common that on Sunday, like we were just talking about jambalaya and nobody working on Sunday, so that also meant that slaves didn't necessarily have to work on Sunday. So this created, it's not idyllic, I'm not saying that everybody was just out partying all the time, but what this meant was folks could actually maintain their culture. That was much harder to do elsewhere in the South under the evils of slavery. And so slaves could go to, so this was originally a place for slaves and a freed black folks. And then it started to become so big that actually other folks started to come to check it out. So now what we have is we have an area sort of inland from the French Quarter called Congo Square. And here's a place folks could go together. They could trade stuff. They could perform their religious practices. They could tell their stories. They could sell stuff. They could sell stuff. So they could maybe make some food, or they could maybe make some clothing or whatever, and sell that and start to accumulate some money. And they could start to save up that money to buy maybe their freedom, or maybe their spouse's freedom, or their kids' freedom, or whatever. And so unusual in the South, right? This wasn't a normal thing that was going on. And so eventually, it started getting super, super popular, and then music became an important thing here, with both the polyphonic rhythms, and then again, like we said, all these other things came together, and this is where ragtime was born. And so this takes, so let's play this while I talk. This is ragtime. This is the famous maple leaf rag. So again, an American take on sort of some classic tropes. So this is a dominant art form in much of the U.S. from the late 1800s up until World War I. This is popular music. It's what the young folks were listening to. That takes us in to the birth of what we would now call jazz. And let's start with, let's actually start with Jelly Roll Morton. So you can hear that ragtime influence. So we have all these people playing this kind of music, right? Buddy Bolden is probably the first guy to play what we would now consider modern jazz. A lot of improvisation. One of the first guys to really just start riffing on his own stuff, doing his own take, doing his own ways of talking with music. We don't have any recorded evidence of him because this was sort of just as the recording technology was coming along. But remember, we had this history in New Orleans of music at funerals, of this social aid and pleasure club, of all these things. So what this meant is, unlike some other parts of the country, you actually might be able to make a living as a musician. If you're a white guy, if you're a black guy, if you're a whatever guy, right? Because there's so much need this music is such an important part of the culture. There's music needed all the time. Add to that Storyville. So Storyville is the red light district. Storyville is where all the, we can say, houses of ill repute were, right? And there were no Walkmans back then or boomboxes or anything. So what they would do is the person that ran the establishment might put up a piano and have a little stage where folks could play music, right? And just like we talked about, music gets you work harder. If you're having a good time and you're listening to music, maybe you're going to spend more money on more drinks and more other activities, right? So a lot of these musicians came through Storyville. So Jelly Roll Morton, the guy that's playing right here, came up in there. A little kid. Let's play this one. So Louis Armstrong. So Louis Armstrong was a little kid and played in Storyville. Played in and around and all this and that. So again, if you're playing day and night, you get really good, right? And you learn a bunch of different songs. A lot of people playing songs. Storyville gets bulldozed in 1917 by some people that don't like that kind of stuff. And try to, again, another one of these waves of, we're going to clean up New Orleans. It doesn't work, but it manages to disperse. It manages to disperse all these folks, these musicians that are concentrated in Storyville. And so these folks start to move up to Chicago, up the Mississippi River, up to Chicago, Memphis, to all these other places, and start to spread this jazz influence and rhythm and blues up and down across the country. So the very first recording that we know of, that people now consider to be the first jazz recording, was by this white group, which is ironic because Freddie Keppard was offered the first jazz recording contract, and he was freaked out. He said, oh man, if you record me, everybody's going to copy me around the country, and then I won't have any you know, way to make money. So unfortunately, he didn't take this, but this is the very first official, it's considered the first official jazz. So from there, we move into the next sort of big era would be the big band era, the swing era. And this would be, here's Fletcher Henderson to give you a sense of what this music is like. So again, this is all popular music. This is all what people would go to clubs to hang out. This is what people would dance with their sweethearts to, that kind of stuff. And now jazz is beginning to spread out from beyond its New Orleans roots. So now we're starting to see major genres grow up in Chicago and New York and all these places around the world. This is really popular up until basically World War II. So we have all that good stuff going. And then we start to get into the massive proliferation at post-World War II. So we have things like bebop with people like Dizzy Gillespie and Thelonious Monk. We have progressive jazz, or sometimes called cool jazz, which is sort of a West Coast thing, dominated by folks like Dave Brubeck, or epitomized by people like Dave Brubeck and Miles Davis.
Miles Davis is a talk like that.
And then we have stuff like hard bop and with folks like Sonny Rollins and Max Roach. Max Roach is a drummer, insane, totally insane drummer. And then we have things like jazz fusion that takes us on into the 70s.